turn to Matthew chapter 11, please. Matthew 11. So, with the sound, with the amplification. Sometimes, Jeremy, with the amplification, if I speak down in the mic, you know, it'll get louder, but don't change it if you can't, you know. I think I'll break your fingers if you change it, no joke. But, then I don't have to be speaking down in the mic, thank you. All right, Matthew chapter 11, verse 25. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knows the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son, and he to whomsoever the Son will reveal him. Come unto me, verse 28, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. So here we have, we have our diagram for our sketch up here. We have the Trinity in eternity, and I draw it this way, as an arrow that has no beginning and no end. And this is the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then he said, come unto me. So we have us living in time here, like Adam and Eve in the beginning in the garden. We have Adam and Eve like this, okay, in the beginning. And they were to come to Christ. Adam and Eve were made to come to Christ. And nobody knows the Father but the Son. So this Trinitarian relationship, Father and Son, is a mystery that people do not know, but is revealed to us. And this is why Christ came into this world, that God sent Christ into the world. We could say it like this. Christ was in eternity, John 3:13, at the same time he was on the earth. Let's read that. John chapter 3. In verse 13. And no man has ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. The Gospel of John is interesting because in John chapter 1, we don't have any genealogy of Christ, like in Matthew and in Luke. Like, we don't have the birth of Christ in John chapter 1. We only have that the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us, but that Word was God. And when he was a man, he was also God. Another interesting thing about the Gospel of John is that there's no ascension of Christ at the end of the Gospel. Christ does not ascend up in heaven in the record. He does, but not in the Gospel of John. Because, in a way, Christ never leaves heaven, but he continues to be the Son of God. Even though he is a man, he is God, and he is in heaven at the same time he is a man. This is important to us because the church is also a mystery, where we could say this way in our little sketch here, that we have been born again, oops, that we have been born again, I lost it. We have been born again, and we are in the Son of God. Look at Matthew 11 again, and that beautiful verse, no one knows the Son but the Father, and he to whom he will reveal him, Matthew 11 and verse 27. All things are delivered unto me of my Father, and no man knows the Son. This is important. No man knows the Son but the Father. Neither knoweth any man the Father save the Son. These are unknown. The Father is unknown and the Son is unknown. But then we see in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 16, and turn there with me, of 16. This unique and very important conversation starting in verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they said, some say that you are John the Baptist, some Elias, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. So here we have the primary issue of the church is the identity of Christ. Who are you? You are a guru, teacher, prophet, rabbi gone wild. You are a unfortunate victim. You are a human being who got in a lot of trouble in Israel. Who are you? A prophet like Isaiah or Jeremiah or John the Baptist. And of course, this is because nobody knows the Son but the Father. And nobody knows the Father but the Son. And now we must have the revelation of the Son of God to us by the Holy Spirit. And this happens in verse 16. He said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Here it is. This is the important thing. And if you look at our diagram, like nobody knows the things of God and can comprehend them or apprehend them because we have sinned, and the result of our sin, oops, there it goes again. Sorry. I don't know why that is. The result of our sin, one more time, and I'm not going to use it at all, is our blindness. The result of our sin is no, that's okay. Is it, am I doing that? Okay. The result of our sin is that we are separated and alienated from God. And the work of Christ when he came into the world was to open to us, to reveal to us, to bring us into the knowledge of God. And when Peter said, you are the Christ, this was a delight to Christ. You actually know me. And if you think about it, it is the most amazing thing that could happen to a person, that I would know that this is the Christ, this is the person, this is the Savior, this is the one that God sent. And isn't it amazing when you look at this book, how much prophecy, how much revelation, how much is said in the book of Isaiah, how much is said in the book of Deuteronomy, how much is said in the Old Testament regarding the Christ, and how little is understood by the Jewish nation in rejecting Christ. It shows us that this is totally beyond flesh and blood. Turn to, keep your finger there and turn to John chapter 1, please. Verse 12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. This is amazing. Legal power to become the sons of God. The right to be a son of God. To as many as received him, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. We are born of God. That's it. That's amazing. We are born of God, and we know who Christ is. This is what he said back in Matthew 16, verse 17. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. Nobody can know the Son, but only if the Father reveals him. And this is the core of the church. The church is that group of people that know the Son of God. And when it happens, when you have one person or two or three, and they know who Christ is, then this is revolutionary. That we were dead unto God, we were without the Holy Spirit, we were without revelation, we were blinded and dead in our sin. And now we have come alive because this is the result of the Son of God coming into the world. The Son of God came into the world, and now there is a church. And what is the church? It is that group of people that realize who Christ is. And blessed are you if you know this, that if you know who Christ is, that nobody knows the Son but the Father and him to whom he will reveal him. And that is why when we have a fellowship and somebody is believing and they are now born of God, then there's an immediate relationship with that person. For that person is now my sister, they are my brother, we are in the family, and they have a capacity to hear what it is that we have to say. To recognize Christ in us, they can discern or recognize, even right away, that, oh, this is something, this is what, oh, I know. And they don't even have the vocabulary, but they have the heart. And they have the patience. They are able to listen, and you're able to feed the flock of God. This is amazing. And I know all of you that are in here that are on the field and pastors for years, you know exactly what it is that we're talking about. Very fundamental. Very, very simple. Very powerful. And also very spiritual. Now, in our class, the things that I am thinking about, like we have techniques and methods and so on, but I am not so fascinated with those things as the higher thing, the deep thing that happens. It is outlined here in this book. This is the reality that people are interested in. Like the kind of room that you use, the sound equipment you have, the location of your ministry, how you operate during the week, how is your schedule every week, every month, every year, what messages you preach, your first 100 messages, for example. Almost 100 messages, what will they be as a teacher? The first 100 messages, when people are born again, what are you going to say to them? How are you going to teach them? How are they going to be established in their faith? Are they going to become hearers? Are they going to start to talk with what it is that they have heard? First, the ministry of the Spirit, the hearing capability, the vocabulary is increasing. How much time do people spend in coming and paying attention to their new life? Do they need to be told, come and be with us? How are they motivated now? This is another big question. People do not come to the church, or they don't come to the cafe or the Bible study. They don't come. How are they motivated? What is drawing them in? And how are they connected? Many very good questions. But the fundamental issue is their new birth and their spiritual capacity for holiness instead of sin. This is awesome. You have a spectrum here. You have a man or a woman that lives in sin, and you have the same person later living in holiness. How does that affect their life? What does it mean when they start making godly decisions? How does revival happen on the inside? How does it happen that they really say, wow? And then for how long a period of time does this last in their life? Are they affected in a spiritual way only for a month or 3 months or a year or 3 years and so on? Good questions. But it is all based simply on, and this is our effort and our labor and our interest, is to know, what does the Apostle Paul say about these issues? How serious is he as a pastor for the church? How jealous is he for what is happening? How much he wants to see people really make progress in their faith? He is very jealous about it. So you have Galatians is a very good example of that jealousy. And what effort he made to communicate to them and to say that what happened to you? Why did you turn aside? How did you get deceived? How have you been bewitched? And then another book that covers the material in a similar way, it a bit differently, but are the Corinthians. How much was he after them? Turn to 2 Corinthians 11 with me and read that. Verse 2. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2. I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. I don't know how to illustrate that. Maybe, let's see, who could I use? I don't know. Let's see. Andy, come on. Would you come up here for a second? Now, Andy's had a spiritual change in his life. He is in the church. I know him. And my distance from him could be, you know, quite far. And he makes decisions. And he is like just off on his own. And he needs me. So I care about him. And I touch his life every once in a while. But I wonder, and this is a good issue, that if we have the reality of Christ operating in our life in the way that we see with Paul, that Paul was jealous for his progress, for his growth, but not manipulative, not controlling, but jealous over the Corinthian church with a godly jealousy. And I wonder how strong it is, you know, how much he would be able to, like, really deal with Andy. You know, how this is only a dramatic illustration because I want to make a point. How much am I caring about this guy's growth and what's going on in his life? And it can be that he goes and he is off like this, but I have to ask the question in chapter 11, verse 2. I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. The word godly is important. Not like I am a control freak. And the minute, you know, Andy leaves my presence, I want to know, where'd he go? What's Andy doing? Who gave him permission to leave the room? Okay, that is so weird, right? Godly jealousy means when I don't see him, I care about him. Godly jealousy means where is he going? But this is not about one person. I'm using one person to illustrate a point. This is a church. And let's say there are seven people in the church. Or 15, or 30, or 100, or 200. Do I care? Verse 2, yeah, I think it's very strong. I am jealous over you with godly jealousy. Now, why? Let's go back to this illustration. Thanks, Andy. I was easy on you. Here is Christ, and here's the body of Christ. Do you see the diagram? What's the head of the body? Christ's head. Does Christ care about his body? Is Christ caring about his church? Is Christ connected with the body? And if you put here the Apostle Paul, he'll say, I am caring that everybody here in the Corinthian church would be right there with what God is doing, what God is saying, what is happening in the faith. I'm caring that these people in the Corinthian church would be apostolic in their doctrine and their training. So read verse 2. For I have espoused you to one husband. What a strange phrase. I have espoused you to one husband. What does this mean? It means as a woman is married to a man, Paul is the one that's linking them up. He is saying, through my ministry, you have been connected with Christ, and I'm jealous that connection would continue. I want you to grow and become everything that you are supposed to be. I want you not only to start well, but to also grow and increase. Verse 2, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear. But I fear. Okay, let's take a moment pause here Turn to your neighbor for a minute and just say, what is Pastor Scheller talking about? What have we been talking about? Anybody? Comment? What have we been speaking about? Yes, Sharon. God's jealousy over the church. Anybody else? What? Not to have spiritual adultery. Yeah, to be drawn away when I am born again and I know who Christ is. Pastor Bob.
I see it as a reflection of the pastor's personal interest for the people.
Yes. Yeah, I really care. But, you really care because if it has happened in your life, and this is important, that if this has happened in my life, if I have found what it is to be a disciple, a follower, to be spirit-filled, to love my Bible, if this happens in my life, then I enjoy bringing that to someone else. I would like you to have that also. But the question is, if we could say it this way, like how does it happen that that in my church, where my home is, there's like roots in my church and where all these people in the church, if this is a fellowship where I, as a member, am increasing, growing, understanding, and enjoying holiness, enjoying the Spirit speaking to me, living and learning and growing, then you have a team that is sent out of these kind of people, and they become the seed for the plant of the church. And the same thing that has happened in their lives will happen wherever it is that they go. And this is something we guard. We recognize it. We see how it can be trampled by the swine, casting the pearls before the swine, meaning my sin nature. How many Christians could have an amazing beginning and then because of their flesh, they walk away from it? And they say, I did that. I read my Bible. I said prayers. I was even a missionary, but I'm gone. I moved on and I'm doing something different. I'm shocked at how that can happen. It has to be guarded. It has to be respected. It's very fragile in a way. It's very tough. The gates of hell cannot prevail against it. But the gates of hell can prevail against a believer. But the gates of hell cannot prevail against the revelation of Christ. Do you see that? Like here is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And if he reveals himself to the church, if we know who he is, that revelation cannot be defeated by the devil. That the Spirit will produce again and again new believers. Whoever believes. That message will never stop. That work of grace will never stop. That message of the gospel will continue on. God will continue to do it, and salvations will continue to happen, and people will continue to be born again. But after you are born again, you could live in the flesh, walk away from it, and not care about it. And this is very possible. There is a learning in the church that is important, and this is you know, right in the church, there must be, in the revelation of Christ, that we have salvation. You know, the sequences, I'm sure you understand this. Justification, that is salvation, and then sanctification. And this is the growth that Paul was jealous for the Corinthians. The Corinthians were to be growing, being sanctified. This happens through the preaching and teaching and the believer taking up the cross. This is important. The cross life. Many of the people here tonight, like A.V. and Tina and many of the folks, Marcy, and we have a room full of people who understand this. We got our training under in the ministry where we learned that our flesh cannot dominate and control our life. If our flesh is controlling and dominating our life, we will lack the internal, the spiritual life. And the result is that my motivation is affected when I lose my spiritual life. I'm no longer interested like I used to be. I no longer read the Bible like I used to read. I no longer pray like I used to pray. I no longer listening to messages like I used to listen to them. I no longer live by faith and a faith vision like I used to do it. We should know this story. I think we do. Because church planting is not the work of man's flesh. It's the work of the Spirit. And growth is not the work of the flesh. It's the work of grace. And Paul said, I fear. Look at 2 Corinthians 11, 3 with me. But I fear. Say that to your neighbor. But I fear. And then you say back to them, what? What? Okay. But I fear. And then you say back to them, but perfect love casts out fear. But I fear. You mean this is apostolic fear. I'm actually concerned. I'm afraid. If I lose this church, we're going to lose a lot of laborers, a lot of workers, a lot of answers, a lot of solutions, a lot of deliverances, a lot of evangelism, a lot of ministry. If we lose the Corinthian church, we're going to lose a great asset. And I fear, he said. All right? So there it is. What did he fear? Verse 3. Lest by any means. What do you mean? Any means. Let's write down a couple of means. Shout them out to me. By any means. By any means. I fear lest by any means. Go ahead, give me one. What? Lies, TV, literature, professors at the university, and other means, church split. How about what other means? Satanic projections. Deceptions, false teaching, false prophets, false apostles are mentioned in chapter 11 and verse 13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers. They are a means. What are they going to do? Verse 3. They beguiled Eve. What does that mean? Beguiled Eve. talk to your neighbor, because you're not free to talk to me. Tell your neighbor, beguiled Eve. What? Pastor Dennis, beguiled Eve was what? What? Enticed her. Okay. Yeah. Enticed her, beguiled her, tricked her, deceived her. You mean the church could be deceived? Yes. Do you think an individual believer can be deceived? Yeah. I fear that this church is going to be deceived, tricked, beguiled, like Eve was in the garden by an angel of light. I am concerned about it. I am jealous over you. What are we fascinated with in this picture? I'm fascinated by the fact that nobody knows the Son, right? This part here. Nobody knows the Son, but you do, Simon Barjona. You know the Son. You know that I am the Messiah, and I need you. I need you to know that. I need you to preach it. I need you to live it. I need you to be my testimony. You are the healing of the nations. The church is the answer for the people of the world. And we cannot fool around with it. It has to happen. The church is that group of people that know who Christ is in a very personal way. And they grow in it and do not turn back from it. Okay, verse 3. But I fear lest by any means as a serpent tricked Eve through his subtlety. It'll always happen that way in America. In churches, there is the drawing away from the revelation of this book, and that people are being entertained instead of preached to, that people have programs for meeting a social need. Let's talk about this. There's this bodily need. Let's see, soulish need, relationship need, and at the very top, this is, you know, the world says this. You first need, your body needs the water, the food, the shelter, then you need to be loved, supported, encouraged, then you need relationships. And this is, you know, Maslow, if you want to Google it, his pyramid of human need. But I don't believe this as a born-again Christian. I believe that, yes, I need these things, but all the way through it, I need God. So I need food, but I need God to give me the food. I need to be loved, but I need God to love me. I need relationships, but I need godly relationships. I need a spiritual understanding, but I need it to come from God, from the beginning to the end. I have needs. Now, I believe that there are people in Vietnam that do not have a church, but they need one. I believe there are people in Cambodia that do not have a church, but they need one. And what is a church? It is what we've been saying. It is the revelation of God's Son. And when I know the Son, then I really have my needs met on a very fundamental level where God becomes my Father, and all the promises that we have from God the Father are given to us here in this awesome revelation. I believe people need a church. I know you do. Why? Because I got one. It changed my whole life. I got one. I had a pastor. I had a Bible college. I had a message. But a message, it wasn't just once a week, but I got one every day. I got one. I had somebody that was jealous over me with godly jealousy. And I think he feared, in the same way the Apostle Paul feared, that all that investment that God has given to you and you would walk away from it, that you would be beguiled, you would be deceived, you would be misled, that later you would throw it away when it was your actual salvation, and that the God that saved you will also sanctify you and make you holy and use you as one of his servants. Yes. That's what we're afraid of. So there is a amazing effort made by us. Where do we get it from? We get it from inside here in this picture of the church here like this. We get it inside with the ministry. And we have three words. We have the Holy Spirit that ministers to us in various ways. We have the Bible that is opened up to our hearts, where we're able to investigate, ask questions, make presuppositions, make calculations, live in faith, embrace it in our walk of faith, and we're able to have relationships with each other that are real and are genuine, not perfect, but are enjoyable. And this is body life. And then we're able to love and reach out and love. And we have churches that plant churches. And those churches plant churches. So we have three elements that you've heard about through the years, 2 and 3. Now, in this simple understanding, but profound understanding, we have many enemies. We have many challenges. We have a lot of opposition. And we want to consider what are the very fundamental elements that make it happen again and again and again. And the point is that in Matthew 11, we see 27, that nobody knows the Son but the Father. And nobody knows the Father but the Son and him to whom he will reveal him. When that happens, there it is. That's it. Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona. Flesh and blood could not do this. My Father has done it, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And it will go on and go on. So that's our first hour of our class tonight. So that's it. Thank you, Jesus, in your name. Now let's go to Ephesians. Well, actually, we didn't finish that verse. I'll just read it to you. But I fear lest by any means a serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety. Pastor Shabelli just said that Satan deceived a third of the angels in heaven. He deceived Adam and Eve in the garden. We see he deceived three people through the Bible. Solomon, King Solomon, is a good example. Judas Iscariot. We see him working against the church. So why wouldn't we also recognize that he is against the church today? He's against discipleship. He's against people living in the Spirit and discovering the holiness of God. So the mind is corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. And this is where people go into complexity in their minds, not simplicity. And this is one of the characteristics of a healthy church, is the spiritual nature of the people. that they are actually very, the Holy Spirit has given them a light, and they understand things in the light of Christ. Love, agape love, is very simple, uncomplicated, very patient, very forgiving. And if you have ever been in spiritual warfare, that you have noticed that the heart of man is like this with a hole in it. Okay? The new heart is without that hole in it. And we can say simplicity. Simplicity meaning oneness. This is a theological term. When you hear that God is eternal, God is unchangeable, but you also have a term, God is simple. Does anybody know what it means? God is simple. It means that he is no parts. No parts. He is one. Father, what do you say? But the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they are three. Yes, they are three, but they are one. They are not parts. They are one. God is one. God is simple. Same with a person. You find that when you go in your flesh, this is when it becomes complex. And this is where the devil wants you to live, in many parts. That's where you have this idea of Romans 7, and my sin nature. Many, many things can be said about it. But healthy church life is a fellowship in simplicity. And this is James 3, the wisdom that comes down from above. So the nature of the church is, we have the pastor, we could draw him like this. We have a Bible. We have the people, small congregation, four people, let's say. And what is happening? But the Holy Spirit relationship with the Word, the people that are listening, they are born again, so they have these relationships that are in simplicity. It's in agape love of 1 Corinthians 13. And they must be taught to love. You do not love by nature. You love as you are learning love from the Spirit of God, who is your teacher. How will I know unless somebody teaches me? That is why teaching is important, and also attending the teaching. You can plan a church and you can have one meeting a week, and your congregation is not going to have the same kind of spiritual vitality as those in Acts chapter 2 when they met every day. Right? But you might say, Pastor, we live in the 21st century. We cannot meet every day. And we counter and say, are you sure? You cannot meet every day. Do you know, can a ministry happen daily? And this is something where I think this is another good little illustration, because the growth, let's just do a graph here. You have a small group of people. These are two people. And then the increase is up to, let's say, 30 people. And this is time. This is months. And what happens in terms of growth? You know, this kind of a idea of a graph, like how does it grow? And what are the, you know, I'm just drawing different kinds of lines. You may start with a few, may go down, and you may be very discouraged because after a year, you don't have much happening. These are all very interesting ways of thinking about what is happening on a spiritual level with the people. And how do you, as a team, manage, observe, and analyze and understand what is going on with the people? And what really is happening? What are the challenges in church planting in the first year? Church planting, and what does it take? Okay, so turn now to Ephesians 4, please. I'll teach for a little bit this class, and then before the end, we'll have Pastor Ronaldo and Pastor Shabelli, and I can sit up here, and we can have questions and have a wrap session. So we are now looking at the principle of investment. So verse 10. He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. That's important. Again, Christ at the center of church life. That Christ, the Bible, is the ministry where my heart and my mind are being, where I'm understanding and hearing about Christ. This is why I go to the church. I'm going to hear about Christ. Let's make a point here. I can hear about Christ or what? You can talk back to me, yeah. What? I'm sorry. Politics, okay. I can hear about politics, self, social problems, news, weather, okay. Yes. I can hear about events and so on, and actually it happens. Even in a ministry where you have an anointing, where you have Christ being revealed, it still happens that after the meeting, people are talking about these things that mean so much to them. And this is where they are living most of the time. So when they come to the church and they hear about Christ, they may hear it in some familiar way. And the Spirit is really wanting to lead them and guide them in the deeper life, but they just have very little capacity for it. Maybe you have met those kind of believers. They have very little capacity. That's why investment is something we should not underestimate what it means to invest. Just flip over to 1 Peter chapter 4 with me and read that verse. We'll go back to Ephesians. Chapter 4, verse 10. As every man has received the gift, even so minister the same one to another, as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. You've received a gift. You minister in that gift. It takes faith to minister in the gift. It takes an attitude of faith. The ministering with your gift is not a natural thing. Ministering with your gift that God gave, he that descended, ascended, and gave gifts unto men. And so here we have verse 10, where we are stewards of the grace of God. Then verse 11, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. Let's put in their politics. If any man speak, let him speak politics, entertainment, light things. He doesn't want to be hyper-spiritual. He doesn't want to be always talking about the Word or about introducing God into the conversation. He doesn't want to be considered to be strange or overly involved or occupied with the ministry of the content of the doctrine. But actually, it is saying the contrarily, that if he speaks at all, he speaks the Word. There's another one, Colossians 3, in verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, abundantly. You always have something. You always have a proverb. You always have a parable. You always have a story. You always have a Bible doctrine. You always have a word in season. You always have something to say because you're investing in people. But of course, we sing, we laugh, we talk, we tell stories, we encourage, we relate, we connect. But then many times the church life is very weak because there is little investment. And there may be little investment because I have received little investment. I have little investment, so that is all that I can give out. You know, I have a little bit. I've been went to Bible college for 1 year, and then I go to the mission field, and I come back, and I say, I don't have enough. I need to know all the doctrines. I need to know the Bible verses. I need to have the meditation. I need to have a prayer life. I need to be reading, studying, preparing, guided, and then I need to invest and care. And when it happens, you can tell it is not hyper-spiritual. There is content there. It is happening. They are listening. The Holy Spirit is doing this work. And these people are increasing in their faith. Look at verse 11. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God gives. God has to give the ability. We don't copy. God gives the ability. I remember years ago there was a pastor in our ministry, and he was like copying Dr. Stevens, and Pastor Stevens would hold the microphone a certain way, and this pastor would hold the microphone in a certain way. Pastor would pause or step over like this, and this pastor would do the same thing, pause and step over, and his body language was like the same. He was copying. And then when we went into our trials, we saw that he didn't really have a spiritual understanding of what was going on. But he caused some trouble and he left. And it was, you have to ask the question, was there content? As we see here in verse 11, if any man, he ministers with the ability which God gives to him, not which he learns in a school of theater, or a comedy book telling jokes or something, and I don't mean Brian Williams because he was fun to be with and so on. I'm not talking about him. Maybe you might think I am. I'm not. But the ability that God gives you, this is Ephesians 4 and verse 11. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. And I want you to think about it. Are those real gifts? I know we kind of, when we read the word apostle, we automatically go, well, there aren't any apostles today. And that's where our meditation is kind of stunted there. But that doesn't matter. The point about the apostles, God gave them, and he doesn't give them today as he did then. But he does give gifts. And these gifts are listed here. And these are important in church planning. And when you go out on a team, you should know who the pastor is and listen to him and realize whether you can submit to his ministry and receive from him. And if you can receive from him, then you can go on in your decision-making if you want to be on his team and be a part of what he is doing, because he is a very important part of what you're going to do. Why be on a team when I cannot receive from the pastor? It just doesn't work. I must have this relationship where I hear, I am edified, I am encouraged, my gifts are brought out, my vision is developed, my desire to be there is part of it, my part of the team is important, and there's an increase. Verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints. This is the part with Andy Castro. Andy, come on back up here for a second. Do I care? Do I care for him? You know, for the gifts are given for the perfecting, a maturation, the development of the saints. And it happens. It's amazing. When people like him are growing and the ladies are growing and are satisfied and edified and learning and increasing, and then some new people come in and the same thing happens to them, and there's like dynamic interaction without the ego, without fighting, without the personality conflicts. They happen, but they do not dominate the fellowship. The ego of the believer, his ego and my ego, are crucified at the cross, and we find ourselves in spiritual fellowship like Jonathan and David, and we realize that there's another third person, and his name is Saul, and Saul hates me, and I don't know why. Or Saul hates him, and we don't know why, but Saul is another part in the church. Saul is the carnal believer who has a problem with the fact that we are happy, that we are satisfied, that we are encouraged, that we are growing, we are increasing, and that God is working there. And Saul just cannot digest that. And so that is a part of church life too. But he and I, we got something going on. There is a maturation in the work. Verse 12, thank you. The perfecting of the saints. Wasn't that an important illustration? How could I have grasped the concept without him being up there? Okay, verse 12. For the work of the ministry. Work of the ministry. The work of the ministry. Work. Say to your neighbor, work, spell it out, work of the ministry. Or the, what's the word? Work of the ministry. Okay. What do you mean? Well, let's just do it this way. Here is a month, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, something like that. Okay. What are you doing in the work of the ministry? I'll tell you what I'm doing. I get up in the morning. I have a prayer. I eat something. I talk about things. I get on the phone. I make a phone call. Now it's time to go to lunch. I go to lunch. I take a nap. I make another phone call. And I think about having a meeting sometime in the week. We'll have a Bible study one day when everything falls together. When it come, when they start knocking on my door and they start looking for a Bible teacher or they start looking for activity. And then I'll decide according to their request what it is that I will do in my work in the ministry. So it's important to think about it. And if you take every one of these days and you divide it, you put it in a week or put one day, how would you divide one day? This is morning. This is afternoon. And this is evening. I've got three parts of the day. What is your philosophy about work? What do you think? What do you do in the three parts of the day? What is your activity? What are you planning? If you are working in a full-time job and you're working 40 or 50 hours a week, then you really have to be careful with your time and what you're doing. If you want to work in the ministry, because when you are taking naps all the time, and by the way, I like those, and actually I need them sometimes, but if that's my lifestyle, then you see the gifts of the Spirit are given in the church so that there'll be the maturing and then the work that must take place in church planting. Do you think you can just plant a church by not doing much? If you take your day and divide it, and you can, we used to say in Finland that you can have two parts of the day are for the ministry and one part is for you. Let me repeat it. Two parts of the day, because we were young and we were able to do it, and maybe that would change. If you're older, I don't know, but this is something to consider. What am I going to do and what is my part? It might be my part is to pray. And if I pray, I'm going to be making a commitment and so on. But we used to say you can have the morning for yourself and then you go out and you evangelize in the afternoon and you attend a meeting in the evening. Or you have you're doing something in the ministry in the morning, you have the afternoon for yourself, and then you're back out in the evening visiting people. Or you're visiting people in the morning, in the afternoon, and then you have the evening free. Yeah, and when we had our team of 10 people, like people looked at me like what kind of tyrannical school did you go to? You know, what kind, you know, who are you to put such heavy workload on us? But actually, if you think about it, it's not a big deal. If you have a whole part, that is for yourself. And of course, this can be changed. I wasn't caring. I said it was a general idea, And people were very industrious and active and willing. But I just want to say that the ministry can't happen without work. And what kind of work and involvement? We have time and we have effort. We also have think sessions with ideas, creativity, and dreaming and thinking outside of the box. Let's have a newspaper, and we say, we've never had a newspaper before. And we would say, yeah, we've never had. Now's the time. Let's make a newspaper. Well, it's going to cost us a lot of money. Yeah, it will. And that's why, we're going to believe God for that. We did seminars, I remember, and that we could tell stories about that. Weekend seminars, conferences, our meetings. We said we're going to do 3 services a week, and they said, well, in Finland, we don't do 3 services a week. And I said, in America, we don't do 3 services a week either unless you're in the Bible Speaks. And when we're in the Bible Speaks, we do 3 services a week. Yeah, but we are in Finland. Yeah, but I'm not here to live like a Finn. I'm here to live like a man of God. I like saying that. You know, they have enough Finns. We don't need another one. They need a man and a woman of God. So we are there for that reason. They said, yeah, but people won't come to church Sunday morning. Well, we'll be there. So that's what happened. They didn't come Sunday morning, but we were there. And we had a church service. Well, why are we having it just with ourselves? Because we need it. Let's do it. We got gifts. Let's use our gifts. The culture isn't entirely going to govern our lives. But we want God to lead us in it. We are not culturally insensitive. We're just saying we will set the pace. We will set the tempo. We'll decide the discussion. We'll talk about the things God wants to talk about. We'll study the Bible. We'll do the things that we do. And people came along and they became like us. That's the point. So there's a good lesson in that. Okay, then chapter 4, verse 12. Gifts are given for the perfecting of the saints, the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Wow. Edifying. If you've been edified and you know what edification is, there is nothing like it. You know, learn to speak encouragement. Speak encouragement. I'm amazed at how little this happens in the world. Encouragement. There's phony encouragement, you know. There are things that people say all the time because of polite society. But that is not edification. When you look at somebody and you say, God has a plan for your life. I am so happy you are here. You know, God is speaking to us. Your prayers are important. Thank you. I'm glad you're here, that you love us and that you care about what is going on. This is very important. There is edification, and I like to think of 3 kinds. Edification, I know your name. Edification, I have a word of encouragement. And edification, I have a specific word of insight for your life. It's amazing if that happens. I have a specific word of understanding for you. That's amazing. When the Spirit says something to you, like that's from God, right to you, you go, wow, where could I ever go to find this? I am so happy to be here. This is my home. So it's kind of like, review this. First one, hi, Ed. Oh, hi. Okay, a little bit superficial, but real, but not so specific, nothing really special about it, being friendly. So that's like edification. Then the Bible teaching, and somebody listens to it, or you share with them and you encourage them, and that's beautiful. And then that specific word that is tailor-made for my life, and I got it. It was like, whoa, I got it. I got, you know, God edified me, and he used people. I may not even know who it was, but God edified me. I am so encouraged and edified with a specific word. It may be a word of conviction for me to repent because I'm fooling around. In that 2 Corinthians chapter 7, and many of the epistles have specific words. How about that one in Philippians and these two ladies, right? Chapter 4, verse 2. I beseech Euodias and beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind of the Lord. This thing, the Bible is going to be forever, and their names are going to be there as two ladies that were fooling around, and they had to be personally rebuked in the epistle, mentioned by name, but I'm going to say, yep, they're going to be in heaven. Yep, that was me. And I'm so glad that God called me out. It was actually edifying. I was noticed. I wanted to be. Okay, so that's that. Pastor Shabelli, would you like to come up? And Pastor Rinaldo? And we'll have a wrap session.